Hello and welcome to the National Centre of Excellence for Home Economics podcast series. The aim of this podcast series is to keep you up to date with the latest information from renowned experts across the globe on all things home economics related. My name is Dr. Elaine Mooney and I'm Director of the National Centre of Excellence for Home Economics at ATU St. Angela's Sligo. On today's podcast, I'm joined by CORA registered dietitian Sarah Keogh to chat through the latest evidence-based research on celiac disease. Sarah is the founder of Eat Well, a food and nutrition consultancy, and has over 25 years' experience working in nutrition. She graduated from Trinity College Dublin with a degree in human nutrition and dietetics and holds a master's in European food regulation. Sarah also works with the Coeliac Society and lectures in nutrition at TU Dublin. You can find Sarah talking all about nutrition on Instagram. Just search for @SarahQRD. Thank you for joining me today, Sarah.
Hi, thank you for having me here.
Sarah, I'm going to hit the ground running here. What exactly is celiac disease?
Celiac disease is an autoimmune disease. So this is where your body is attacking itself. And in celiac disease, it is triggered by gluten. So if someone is celiac, when they eat gluten, gluten causes their body to attack itself in their gut. It causes gut damage, and this reduces their absorption of foods and nutrients. But the gluten can also travel to other places in the body, so it can affect the nervous system, giving people brain fog, pins and needles, very severe fatigue. It can affect bone health. It can affect growth in children and in teenagers, and it can affect fertility. So it has an effect right across the body.
Okay, so to be crystal clear, Sarah, we're saying that celiac disease is neither an intolerance or an allergy.
Yeah, so it's interesting. So even though you have to avoid gluten with it, it's not an allergic reaction and it's not a food intolerance. It is an autoimmune disease.
Okay. And Sarah, are there any long-term complications, for example, if you didn't comply with the gluten-free diet or if you were undiagnosed?
So we know that 75% of people with celiac disease in Ireland are not diagnosed, and we do know there's a lot of long-term complications for that. In children and teenagers, they don't get their growth that they need, and they also don't get their energy levels, so it can affect grades in school and things like that. Later on, we know it affects bone health, so osteoporosis is more common. There's also more likely to be problems with fertility. So people are more likely to find it difficult to become parents too, and there are more miscarriages and more stillbirth. And there is, now it's quite rare, but there is a specific type of cancer, bowel cancer, that's associated with untreated celiac disease. And typically we find that in people in their 60s. So we've a lot of good reasons why we want people to be diagnosed with celiac disease and to follow the diet, get the treatment that they need.
Okay. And Sarah, we used to think that Ireland had the highest incidence of celiac disease in Europe. And I even remember myself reading in nutrition books at the time that Galway was thought to have the highest incidence in Europe. But that's not considered the case any longer.
No, and it probably never was. It was just there was a little more research going on in Ireland about celiac disease. And so we were finding out more because, you know, if you go back even 30 years ago, people thought that you had like one in 10,000 people had celiac disease. Now we know that it's one in 50. So if you started doing more research on it, you would start to find it. What we do know now is Finland seems to have the highest rate. Now, again, they are doing a huge amount of research on it. So they're looking at maybe one in 50 in Finland as well. But they're going to start screening for celiac disease in children in Italy in the next couple of years. They're just going to screen all the children for it. So once we do that, we'll see what the rates really are.
Okay, so perhaps at the time in Galway, they were doing studies on celiac disease and that might have given the rise for that figure.
That was it. We were just finding them. Yeah, it doesn't seem to be any higher in Ireland than anywhere else.
Okay. Does genetics play a role?
Huge role. So there's two particular genes that are involved in celiac disease. Or two variants of the gene. So the thing is, 30% of people will carry the gene for celiac disease, but obviously 30% of people don't have celiac disease, so there is a trigger. So we know that you have to have the genetics for it, and there needs to be a trigger, which is probably a virus. But what we do know is it runs in families. So we've talked generally 1 in 50 people will have celiac disease, but if you have a brother or sister or parent or child with celiac disease, that jumps to 1 in 10. It's 1 in 20 if you have a cousin with celiac disease. So if you do have someone with celiac disease in your family, it's actually very important to get tested yourself.
Okay, that's very interesting. And so we know, you know, that celiac disease is known as a multi-system disorder. You touched on it there already, Sarah, as in that it can affect any area of the body. But the main symptom, Sarah, for people to look out for?
About 60% of people will get gut symptoms, which would be, could be diarrhea, could be constipation, could be bloating, stomach pain, excessive burping, and passing a lot of gas. And they'd all be quite common symptoms. Now, they wouldn't even be every day. It might actually, you might only get them twice a week or once a month. And sometimes people think, well, they're too mild to be anything more serious. But actually, if you're kind of getting a funny tummy kind of regularly, you do need to check it out. What we also get is tiredness. That's a big one. People feeling really, really tired and difficulty concentrating and focusing are other big signs. Then what you might see is delayed puberty. So girls might have later periods. They can be affected as well. Boys might get that growth jump that, you know, you usually see around that mid-teens. So they'd all be signs of it as well and things that you need to check out. There's also a very specific rash you can get. It comes up like a little yellow blister, but it's so itchy everyone scratches it, so it's kind of scabby, and it will turn up on the outside of both elbows or the outside of both knees. It can turn up in other places in the body, but the classic one is the front of your elbows on both sides with this really itchy rash. Is a really big sign of celiac disease.
Oh my gosh, and I have never actually heard that before, so that's really interesting.
It's a good name. It's called dermatitis herpetiformis, if you want to look it up.
Oh, brilliant. It's good to have a name like that, so that if you do have a rash, you know exactly what you're looking for. In relation to the diagnosis, there are two ways, really, isn't that correct, that you can be diagnosed?
So
blood test.
So basically what you'll do is you'll start by having a blood test. But what's absolutely essential is you must be eating gluten for at least 6 weeks before you have any celiac tests. Because once you cut the gluten out, the tests will go back to normal and you'll think you don't have celiac disease. So the first rule, keep eating gluten. You go to your GP. You don't waste your time going to food sensitivity tests and hair testing and all of that sort of stuff into your doctor. And it's a blood test. And if the blood test is high, you may need then to have a biopsy to confirm it. Now, in younger people under 18, if the blood test is extremely high and you're very symptomatic, they will often be able to diagnose you with celiac disease just with that. But for adults and for people under 18 who have a blood test that's middle of the road, you would then have a biopsy done. And the biopsy is painless. It's a bit of a non-event, really.
And the biopsy, what does that involve, Sarah?
So what your doctor will do is they will give you some medication to relax you, and then they will put a camera down your throat into your stomach, and it goes through your stomach out into the first part of your small bowel, which is called your duodenum. And they will take four little pinches of skin from there. It's totally painless. And when they come back up, then they'll send them to a laboratory where they're examined, and they'll be able to look from there and see if you have celiac disease.
Okay, so that's more, I suppose, the first protocol is the blood test, and then this is a further more definitive test then.
It is. Well, one thing to remember is that 10% of people with celiac disease will be negative on the blood test. So the blood test isn't a definite test one way or the other. So you can be negative, but if you're still having symptoms, you might still need to go to get the biopsy to rule it out, especially if celiac disease is in your family.
Mm. And also, it is quite hard to eat the gluten for 6 weeks if you... You know, are very sick.
Yes. And that's the problem. Sometimes people will come off it and then they feel so well that to go back on it is just a huge ordeal. So they don't. But it's very important you actually get diagnosed, because you get some supports and things like that. But you also need regular testing. You're going to need bone scans, all of that. The diagnosis actually is really, really important to get. So if you think gluten is, or wheat or anything, is doing anything to your body, go and get tested for celiac disease before you cut anything out, because it is so much harder to go back onto it for the test.
Yes. And can we just talk through then the gluten-free diet, please, Sarah?
No problem. So gluten is found in wheat, rye and barley, and it is found in what we call ordinary oats. So oats themselves don't have any gluten, but oats are grown in a field beside a wheat field. They are harvested in the combine harvester that had wheat in it yesterday. So by the time, you know, ordinary oats get into the supermarket, they are completely covered in gluten. So people with celiac disease, most of them can eat what we call gluten-free oats. So these are oats specially grown. 5% of people with celiac disease will react to a different protein in oats called avenin. And unfortunately, they need to avoid oats as well. But for most people, wheat, rye, barley and gluten and ordinary oats, they do need to avoid. So that's bread, biscuits, cakes, pastries. Those are the big foods. So you'll often see gluten-free bread, gluten-free pasta, all of those. The bigger difficulty is that wheat and gluten is used as tiny ingredients in thousands of foods. So you can find gluten in tomato ketchup, you can find it in mayonnaise, you can find it in stock cubes, you can find it in herbs and spices. It is all over the place. And that's the big difficulty for a lot of people with celiac disease, is they need to avoid every single bit of gluten. There's no wiggle room with this. You can't have a day off. So the amount of gluten that will trigger a reaction for people with celiac disease is often called 20 parts per million. And one of the best descriptions I've had of that, when I was talking to a farmer who grows gluten-free oats, he says if he has 1 million grains of oat and there are 20 grains of barley in that, those oats are now no longer gluten-free. So I think the other one I loved was someone saying it's the same as 20 seconds in 11 days. So very tiny amounts of gluten are enough. So that's why people have to be really careful about what's in their packaged foods, but also if one part of their food touches another. So if you have a gluten-free muffin and it touches an ordinary muffin, that muffin is not gluten-free anymore. So it is that strict. So people with celiac disease, they have to avoid anything that has wheat, rye, barley or oats in it, but they also then have to check, is there a may contain gluten? And they have to make sure their food hasn't touched anything. They need separate butter. You know, if you make toast and you get crumbs in the butter, there's more than enough gluten in that now to make someone with celiac disease sick. So they need their own butter, jam, marmalade. If you cook ordinary chicken nuggets in a deep fat fryer, that oil is now full of gluten. So if you want to cook chips for someone with celiac disease, you actually have to clean the whole deep fat fryer out and put fresh, clean oil in. So that's where it gets very difficult for people with celiac disease. So the Coeliac Society, we produce a list every year where we talk to food manufacturers and we make sure that there's no gluten in the ingredients, there's no gluten on site. So there's no chance of cross-contamination with it, because although you can look at food labels and they do have to tell you if there's gluten in the ingredient list on food labels, they don't have to tell you about the cross-contamination, which is, you know, you see the may contain where it says may contain gluten or may contain peanut. There's no law says you have to do that. So even you might have a food that doesn't mention gluten on the label but does still contain gluten. So the Coeliac food list is the guaranteed gluten-free list for people, and they get a new one every year.
But Sarah, there is legislation around the actual labelling of the gluten-free foods.
There is. So if you want to call, if you want to put the words gluten-free on your label, it must have less than the 20 parts per million that I was talking about earlier. So those foods have to be laboratory tested, or they have to have very strict controls in place. So if you do see a product that says gluten-free, that is going to be safe and it's really carefully controlled and monitored. It's foods that don't mention anything about it that we then have to be a little more careful about.
Yeah, and I know, Sarah, we speak about, you know, cross-contamination when we're talking about food safety.
Yes.
But really what you're speaking about there is cross-contamination when you're preparing foods for celiacs too.
Exactly. So we might call it cross-contact or cross-contamination. Both terms would be used. But it is exactly that. If you have a toaster, you have to have a separate toaster for someone with celiac disease, because the gluten gets stuck on the inside of the toaster, and then you toast the celiac bread and now it has gluten all over it. So it's really, when you stand back and look at your kitchen, think of all the places you could touch gluten if you were celiac, and think how I need to wipe down before I start cooking. Have I got clean oil? You know, if I put gluten-free sausages in the same tray as ordinary sausages, those juices swap around. So the gluten-free sausages are not gluten-free anymore. So it's really keeping the foods very, very separate. And it does need to be that strict. Sometimes people think someone with celiac disease is just being difficult, or, you know, sometimes we're not nice about people who have to have special diets, but they're not being difficult. Some people can be seriously, seriously unwell when they eat gluten.
And Sarah, there are naturally free from gluten foods.
There
like
are.
Meat. Yeah,
there is. So you have, I mean, foods that would be naturally gluten-free will be all your fresh meat, chicken, fish. They're all fine. Yeah. It's only when you start putting breadcrumbs onto them or sauces that you have to check. Fresh fruit and vegetables will all be gluten-free. You know, you're looking at herbs and spices. Fresh herbs are fine, but there is contamination with dried herbs and spices, so you need to just check for gluten-free ones. Things like beans and lentils, again, would be naturally gluten-free, but we are finding that most lentils in Ireland are contaminated with gluten these days. So we do have two brands of lentils in our food list that are safe for celiacs, and only two, which is all we've been able to find. Your dairy will all be naturally gluten-free as well, unless they start adding flavour. So plain yogurt will be gluten-free, but if you have a fruit yogurt, you need to check your celiac list to make sure that it is gluten-free.
And Sarah, may I ask you there in relation to alcohol? Are they, you know, are there suitable alcoholic drinks?
There are.
For gluten free.
Beer is made with barley, so it has gluten in it, and often with wheat, but you can get gluten-free beer now. But also wines and spirits will be gluten-free, even ones made with wheat, things like whiskey, because of the distillation of it, there isn't any gluten in it. What you might watch is mixed drinks. And just if you have things like liqueurs, you might sometimes just check what would be in there for those, but they're fine. But things like tea and coffee are fine. Things like, you know, they would say coffee in vending machines is a potential cross-contamination risk for gluten in those. But if you're making coffee at home, that'll be gluten-free, or tea is going to be fine as well.
And one thing too is important to check, it would be your supplements, you know, that the actual, we'll say, casing on the capsule is gluten-free.
It is. And the same with medicines, although the vast majority will have no gluten in them. And even if they do, it's generally at a low enough level not to be an issue. But if someone is concerned, they can contact us and we can check. But with supplements, most you'll see supplements that actually say gluten-free on them. And they tend to be the ones that we'd recommend. And people with celiac disease do benefit from a general multivitamin when they're diagnosed, because they can be low in quite a few vitamins with that. They're often low in vitamin B12 and iron, but also vitamin D and then some of the other B vitamins. So I'd usually recommend that they take a good multivitamin for maybe 3 to 6 months. After that, they always need to take vitamin D. So it's very important. Osteoporosis and bone health is a huge issue for people with celiac disease. Yeah. And, you know, it's a very common disease in Ireland, osteoporosis. So it's affecting 1 in 4 men, 1 in 2 women. So the vitamin D is very, very important for people with celiac disease to take all year round. Everybody else needs to take it in the winter, but celiacs need it all year round.
That was something I was going to actually say to you. There are two diet related conditions that we need to kind of talk about when we speak about celiac disease, and that you have mentioned there, the osteoporosis and also the lactose intolerance.
So about 10% of people with celiac disease will be temporarily lactose intolerant when they're diagnosed. And what happens here is that the damage to the gut caused by the gluten also makes it difficult for the gut to manage the lactose in things like milk and yogurt. But it's usually temporary. So for most people, after about 6 months on the gluten-free diet, most people can go back onto the dairy with no problem at all. But if you think you might be lactose intolerant, you'd be bloated. You will have enormous amounts of gas, and I can't emphasize enough the enormous amounts of gas. You might have diarrhea with it, but not always. But the big one is abdominal bloating and huge amounts of gas. But again, don't take yourself off dairy without checking with a registered dietitian first, because particularly I see people cutting out dairy straight away, and that might not be the cause, but they're suddenly losing all of their calcium and their growth just comes to a halt, or they do damage to their bones. So you never self-diagnose anything like this. Always make sure you see a registered dietitian.
And that's really important, you know, to see somebody who has Coru, who is a Coru registered dietitian. In relation to the villi, how long does it take for them to heal? Or presumably it's all inflamed if you've been exposing yourself to the gluten.
It varies from person to person. It is quite unique. So the villi are the little fingers that sort of dip down out of your bowel and absorb your food. So they're the big focal point in terms of damage with celiac disease. With very young children, they come back very rapidly. Like within 3 to 5 days, they'll often be back. So young children very quickly will feel better. Teenagers can be quite the same, really quite quickly. Usually within maybe 4 to 6 weeks, we see teenagers feeling substantially better. The older you get, the longer it takes. So the closer to 50 you are, the longer it takes. So people over 50, it may take 2 years. It may never fully heal. In people who are diagnosed over 50, which is again why we are trying to get people diagnosed much younger with it, that they don't have a lifetime of damage to the gut. But typically, if someone wasn't feeling much better within about a year, we would go back and look and see if something else was going on, because you can, there's a couple of other conditions, gut conditions, that can travel with celiac disease. So there's a slightly higher risk of colitis, there's a slightly higher risk of Crohn's disease as well. Now, it's not huge, but we would have a look at that. And sometimes, again, after a year, if people are struggling, they might be oat sensitive. So we might just need to take them off the oats and see what's going on there as well.
Okay. And, you know, when you talk about that, sir, it's all very complex. You need the help of a registered dietitian. You shouldn't, as you said, cut out the groups yourself, you know, the
very
dairy
true.
Groups or the wheat. And that's something that people do.
Well, what happens is sometimes you're talking to someone or your friend says, oh, have you tried this? Or someone else says, have you cut out that? Or, you know, and we talk a lot about nutrition. I often think we'll very quickly go to see a physiotherapist, but we seem to be very slow about actually going to see a dietitian. But for celiac disease, diet is the treatment, and it is quite complex. And I've touched on what we need to cut out for this. But with people with celiac disease, we need to look at that they're getting enough vitamin D, enough calcium, protein is important. A lot of the time when people are diagnosed with celiac disease, their fiber levels drop in their diet. And it's quite common for them to gain a little bit of weight as well. So we need to really monitor and check all of that, and particularly to monitor growth in children and teenagers who we want to see them do a lot of catch-up growth. So they need to be monitored, and it is very important. So your GP can refer you to one of the dietitians in the HSE, or there's private dietitians. And at the Coeliac Society, I run a dedicated celiac clinic for newly diagnosed and existing people with celiac disease to help them. And what we do know from research on it is that people who sort of go it alone with the gluten-free diet, 80% of them are still eating gluten and getting symptoms 7 years later, whereas those who go to see the dietitian typically get well sorted out quickly. So it's very important to get the proper advice with it.
Okay. And Sarah, you know, I also want to ask you about gluten sensitivity and wheat intolerance. I think they're terms that are, you know, there's a lot of ambiguity around them. And I was just wondering if you could kind of clear it up.
No problem. It does get very confusing because wheat has a couple of things in it that people can react to. Now, wheat isn't alone in this. There's lots of foods will do the same thing. But wheat has gluten in it, which obviously if you're celiac is going to be an issue. But you can also have a condition called non-celiac gluten intolerance, which is where you are having a very definite reaction to gluten, but it's not the autoimmune celiac reaction. And with the studies we have on that, it does seem to be causing a little bit of inflammation in the gut. Now, with celiac disease, you have to avoid all gluten all the time. With gluten intolerance, sometimes people can tolerate a little bit of gluten, so they often don't need to be quite so strict. But what I find is a lot of people I work with non-celiac gluten intolerance, when we really get into it, we usually find out that they are celiac and the blood test maybe just didn't work for them. But there is definitely a separate non-celiac gluten intolerance condition. Wheat then also has other proteins that you can have a full allergic reaction to. So that's what we call your IgE, immune system reaction. So you could have a wheat allergy. And wheat also contains a thing called fructan. And fructan, if you've read anything about irritable bowel syndrome and the low FODMAP diet, fructan is one of what we call a FODMAP. And if you're a little bit sensitive to fructan, that can cause constipation, bloating in some people as well. So sometimes you might know, well, when I eat bread, I really don't feel good. But it could be gluten, it could be a wheat allergy, it could be fructan sensitivity. So what you do is you start with your GP and you rule out celiac disease, and then you see your registered dietitian, and your registered dietitian will be able to go through what's going on with your gut and find out if it's fructan or other things going on with that. So that's how you have a look. But yes, it's very easy to get confused when there's so many different things be causing the problem.
Yeah, and I think certainly another one not to do alone at home is the FODMAP diet, because really needs specially trained advice, isn't that
it
correct?
It really does. It's such a complex diet, and I have to say sometimes I see patients are diagnosed with irritable bowel syndrome and they're handed a one-page sheet, and I nearly just want to cry because it's quite a complex diet. And the thing is, it works so well when it's done properly. But even though I'm a qualified dietitian, when I have to go and do training on FODMAP, it's a 3 full days of training for me to go and do that. Yeah. You know, and I often think someone's trying to do this because they did a Google search, you know, online. Go if you have any kind of issue, bowel issue, your registered dietitian and your GP is the place to go.
Sarah, thank you so much for joining me today and for updating us on the latest evidence-based research on celiac disease. And also thank you to our listeners. So thanks, Sarah.
No problem. And just to say, there's loads of information on celiac disease at our website at celiac.ie.
Yes, and that's really good resources there to be found as well. So thank you.